We gonna run it back. We was in it. We gotta run it back though.
Give me a second.
Yeah, it's okay.
You all right?
At last, my love has come along, and life is like a song.
Trying to tell you.
I am Bishop Ezekiel Williams. I've always had a dream to build the world's most inspirational choir. Pharrell is my nephew, and we recruited a panel of expert judges.
If we didn't have to pay for it, I'd tell you to drop the mic.
Each singer will just have one shot. There will be no callbacks.
You should probably judge them on their ability to be compatible.
So we'll do what I like to call shaking the tree.
Now, if she kills this, the spot is hers.
I want to share my life through music. I want to help others the way others' music have helped me.
We have a lot of people that are doing things that they should not be able to do.
I suffer from social anxiety.
When I came to, I was paralyzed from the neck down and told I'd never walk again.
Suicide attempts, they failed, so like I have no choice but to keep going.
Wow.
How many real opportunities in life do you get?
I want to be in this choir pretty bad and contribute to something bigger than myself.
Without further ado, the voices of fire.
Okay, all right, so I'm gonna have to do it again, Patrick. Please excuse me, the Prince of Choirs. I love that, but I was saying, I saw the first episode of BOF, and off the rip, you're my favorite character. You have this big, energetic personality, and that's what you're known for, right? And you're choir directing.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah, so my first question for you is, I heard you say something along the lines of you're too churchy for other genres. What is it that you love the most about directing choirs and music for the church?
I feel like that's where I'm able to be me the most.
Right, uh-huh.
I feel like that's where I'm able to express what's on the inside. When I'm directing and I'm singing, mm-hmm. while some people view it and they think that's just me performing, I'm really not, because I'm really not paying them that much attention as much as I'm just in my own world. This is my outlet. This is how I'm expressing my joy. This is how I'm communicating mm-hmm. with God. Like,
yep.
It's all of that. Because really, when the music is not there, I would be the kind of person in a room full of people that's just going to stand off in the corner.
Yeah, know? Right. That's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So you currently serve under the Ricky Diller, which is amazing. Yeah. I want to know, I want some of this wisdom. What is the most profound thing that you've learned under his mentorship thus far?
He taught me, he says, son, whatever you do musically, mm-hmm. you have to be able to live with it. I said, but here's the kicker. You need to be able to die with it. I said, huh? He said, when you die, if you put out something good, it becomes greater. When you die, if you put out something bad, it becomes worse. And when you leave this earth, you want people to be able to say nothing but amazing things about your music, because you don't get any slack because you're dead. They're gonna
right.
talk about you more. So he said, whatever you record, whatever you publish, be able to live and die with
mm.
stuff with you.
That's amazing. Okay, so I know you can't give too many spoilers, but what would you say was one of the most challenging things in putting this choir together?
The most challenging thing for me was the fact that it was multicultural.
Mm.
Multi-ethnic, diverse background. Some people never sang gospel music before, never even been to church.
Right.
So now I had to take what I've been doing all of these years, and I find it easy to do with a certain group of people. Now I had to try to get them these people to understand and do it well in a short amount of time.
Oof.
And I'll say it was good for me.
Okay, how so?
Because it stretched me, it challenged me.
Mm.
Because when you deal with, I can easily go and talk car talk with a bunch of mechanics.
Mm-hmm.
They'll understand what I'm saying, you know.
Right.
But I can't talk car talk with a beautician or a dentist or a five-year-old, you know.
That's right.
So same thing musically. When I'm around people that I'm normally used to working with, they understand everything. They understand the culture. They know what I mean. They know everything. Here it is with people that don't know, mm-hmm. and I got to get them to understand and then not just understand, but enjoy it.
Yes.
It's challenging, and it caused me to find different ways to teach. I felt like I was a high school or elementary school teacher or mm-hmm. a parent that's trying to find new ways of getting their toddler to eat vegetables.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right. Okay, that's cool. So I grew up singing in the choir as well.
Okay.
And here's the thing. A friend of mine recently asked me, what's a hidden talent that you have? And I shared with them, you know, a little nervous that I can sing. But here's the thing. It's always been a fear of mine. And the reason why I enjoyed singing in the choir was because I could blend in, you know, nobody could really hear me. So my question for you is, as a choir director, do you feel like you can peep talent in someone who really has a voice, even when they try to hide it?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
You can't hide from Patrick Riddick. I'm going to tell you what.
Okay.
I can tell when somebody's faking, like uh-huh. they're quiet. Tell me something. But you're really not singing. I can tell when you're hiding mm-hmm. behind somebody and you're not really sure your part. You know, mm-hmm. I'll tell them in a minute, listen, you can't fool me. I can hear Canary Brick wind in Georgia. You're not
That's hilarious. Okay. That is so cool. Okay, so now I want to flip it a little bit.
Okay.
My platform is called Faith and Fame, and the reason is because I think that we need to get to a place where we can join and bridge the gap between the faith industry and the secular community, right?
Yeah.
So my question for you is, as a believer, what do you feel like the role of the believer is right now, not just in the church, but with the climate that we're in? You know, we have so much racial segregation and civil unrest. What do you think our role is as the believer right now?
Our role is to drive home the idea that we are better together.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It is my belief that everything that happens bad, even down to crime, if it's robbery, if it's murder, whatever, extortion, it's all division. Mm-hmm. It's
right.
Because somebody just lacks respect for another person.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't respect you. I didn't respect your life. I don't value your life. So I don't find it hard to murder, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't respect your hard work. So I can set up shop in your company and embezzle funds or whatever it is. Here it is. We're dealing with the racism and all that kind of stuff. I don't respect or honor your ethnic background. And so mm-hmm. I find it easy to be disrespectful and discriminatory. And so it is, you have this choir that is comprised of so many different people, and millions of people are going to see just how great and how powerful it is when people put their pride aside, set right. down their egos, forget about backgrounds, nationalities, and all that, and just come together just to make music and then push each other to help each other reach their goals. And they're going to see where it lands you. It landed us here on Netflix doing this. I've been doing music for years. I have my own choir. My own recording choir is amazing. But guess what? I was able to get here doing this that much faster because I linked up with my Caucasian brothers and sisters. All of us coming together, and it's dope. And the relationships are authentic. Like, I talk to them every day.
Mm-hmm.
And I really do.
That's amazing. A beautiful thing. Yeah, agreed. Okay, so on the topic of church, church hurt is a real thing. I have a lot of people, friends that talk about, you know, their experiences in the church and how sometimes, you know, those in the church, you know, our Christian brothers and sisters can tend to push people away by being overly judgmental. But in terms of music, music can be so healing. How do we use music or, you know, the choir to bring back those who have been church hurt or provide a safe space for them to feel like they can come back?
I think that there's going to be an element required with the music, mm-hmm. and that is being authentic, mm-hmm. being mm-hmm. real. Church hurt comes about here again because of divisiveness, mm-hmm. and a lot of people want. I find it easy to talk about somebody in a negative manner across the pulpit or to discriminate this, that, and the third because I'm not honest with myself, nor am I candid about my testimony. The Bible, there's a reason that the Bible says we are overcome mm-hmm. by the word of our testimony and through the blood of the Lamb. How can somebody identify or want to come to church? If I come to church, I don't see anybody like me. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to draw anybody with a big collar on and a whole bunch of robes. I'm not talking against that because there are those in it that are going to have that. But then they need a Patrick Riddick. They yes. need you. They need this person that may be, I don't know, dealing with depression or whatever. And then they need them to say, hey, I was depressed for a long time, mm-hmm. but I kept coming to church. I kept singing. I kept worshiping. And this is what it hit me. And so because I'm still standing here, you'll be able to make it too. So with the music bringing the world in back to the question you asked is, I teach the singers, be your authentic self.
Right.
Let your testimony come through your music. Put yourself yes. in the music and let the music get inside you. And people are going to connect with that.
Yep.
And they're going to come in because it takes away the judgment. This is the no judgment zone.
Right.
Get some of this.
And yes, yes. Absolutely. Okay, so what about those who would argue that I don't need to go to church. I don't have to be in a physical house of God because we are the church, which we are. But what would you say in terms of getting people in the house of God? What is the difference between actually being in a physical house versus just us being on the street?
You need the fellowship. That way? You need the fellowship. If yeah. you're on the street, I'm from the street. I grew up on the street. And right. there was nothing better than when it was time for me to hang out with the fellas. And we all in our clan, and we all would go to the football game. Or we all went to the skate ring or whatever we want to do. You need the fellowship. Why is it that now, because I'm saved, all I need is King Jesus. I don't need nobody else. No.
right.
Fellowship, because where are you going to draw your strength from? When I need to talk to somebody, when I need advice, or when I just, you know, whatever it is, I need my Christian brothers and sisters that I can go yes. to. We've been in a pandemic, and the truth is we have not been able to go into public worship like we normally have. Now,
right.
now I will admit my relationship with Christ is stronger because I have not been in church, so I have to really pray to him myself. I have to study him myself. We do virtual worship. But aside from all of that, there's something inside of me that yearns to be with the saints.
Yes.
In corporate worship. I'm a worship and I'm a praise by myself in the house. I got my daughter. But when I'm able to get with my brothers and sisters and do it, it's amazing. So yeah, right. You do need your relationship with Christ, but you need the fellowship. And the Bible says, forsake not the assembly of the saints. You need the fellowship. It's not good for you to be alone.
Right. Absolutely. You need that corporate prayer and worship. I agree. So you mentioned something about the pandemic and how we're not able to really go in the physical house of God right now. For those who would argue, you know, the pandemic has been a challenge for everybody in a different way. For those who would say, how can you still declare God to be a good God? We're in the midst of a global pandemic. How do you convince them that God is still good?
Let me tell you something.
Let's go. Let's go.
I give you my testimony. The pandemic came. I have a day job, but I still do music. And the reality, right. what I do musically, I like to call that my mad money. My day job pays my mortgage and that kind of stuff, but it doesn't leave me with a bunch of extra money.
Right.
The pandemic hit and dates were canceling left and right. And I'm sitting here just like, Lord, you know, I got to raise my daughter. She goes to private school, this and the third. I got to raise And I watched God, and it was nobody but God. I watched God in the midst of a pandemic.
Let's go. Let's talk about it.
Opened up doors, and I experienced more wealth and wellness
Same.
In a pandemic than I've had in years when I've been up and down in an airplane, and I'm rested, and I'm whole. Mm. I have a clear mind. I'm not tired.
So good. So good. So good.
He has been a provider in the midst of a pandemic. Y'all, they can't tell me. He's good. Sometimes he lets the famine come so that he can prove who he really is.
Right. Yes. I mean, his provision. I say the same thing people ask me all the time. How are you holding up in the pandemic? And I said, baby, listen, God has been providing. I ain't skipped no beat.
No beat.
No beat.
Yo, I even bought a car. I bought a car.
Yes. Come on. That's like, amazing.
You know, but
that's amazing.
God is God, and he's good. I'm telling you,
yes.
Those that have trusted him, and I haven't heard of anybody that I know truly trusts God that suffered during this pandemic. Everybody I've talked to are just like yourself saying, you know what? God is right with me.
Because this pandemic did not catch him by surprise. Hello. Ooh.
Okay, you about to make me run.
Just saying. He knew what was up. He knew. That is amazing. Okay, so I'm going to get, I need two more things from you real quick. I saw in the first episode, you could sing a little opera.
Ah.
What I got to do to give me a little something real quick.
Oh, opera. Oh my God.
Just a little something, please.
And I hadn't even sung it since. Oh my God. I can't even, what was,
I forgot what it was called. Don't get me the line, but I mean, you hit them notes so effortlessly.
Oh my God. And I haven't studied music and yet, that kind of music. I'm trying to remember words to a song that I could do it and give you a little time. Let me see. this is so
funny. This is so funny. I love it.
Let me see.
You got this.
My child and peace attend thee. All through the night.
I mean, the talent, and you so humble with it. There ain't no way I could do that on the spot. Don't be. All right, I got one more thing for you. I do this thing that I like to call an elevator sermon.
Okay.
So whatever's on your heart, give me a quick 1-minute sermon for the people.
Don't give up this show. People that have had many obstacles, be it physical, mental, spiritual, family, career, school, whatever, that warranted them giving up, I myself included. Had I given up, you would not be talking to me today. So I say that every day that you continue, that is each day that you're putting yourself closer to your destiny. You cannot stop. You cannot stop. Don't do it.
Can't stop, won't stop.
Can't stop, won't
Thank
stop.
You so much. You're a ton of fun. I look forward to the rest of the season, and I appreciate you speaking with me in Faith and Fame.
Thank you for having me. I look forward to doing it again.
All right, take care, Patrick. See you.